All right. So you asked, unfortunately, what happens when the learner is now a part of this? Now, the learner doesn't have that advantage that the teacher had of knowing what the actual answer was and therefore being able to show specifically what's irrelevant and show what's relevant. So what could the learner do to try to learn about this? So again, remember that there are 3 to the k possible hypotheses, and if it could use the 20 questions trick, it could do this in log base 2 of 3 to the k, which is the same as k times log base 2 of 3, which is, you know, worse than what we had. This is larger than 1, but it's still linear. It's still linear in k. So, but can we actually do that?
I'm going to say yes.
I don't think we can. So can you help me figure out how that would go?
Oh, I was just going to assert it and hope you would tell me. How would we do that? Well, the trick we did before is we tried to find a specific question we could ask such that we would eliminate half the hypotheses.
Indeed. But it's not clear how you could even ask such a question. Yeah, so just to do this as a thought exercise, I have a hypothesis in mind.
Okay.
And you can ask me anything you want, and I will tell you true or false. But you're going to have a very painful time finding it.
Yeah, but that's just because I'm human. Okay, so I need to find a question where, I have all the possible 3 to the k hypotheses. I want to try to come up with something that's going to eliminate a third of them, which is just going to be hard for me to do because I could write the program to do this.
I'm not sure you could. I think at the moment because I didn't choose my hypothesis at random. I chose a specific hypothesis, though I guess I could have chosen at random from a subset, and you would still have a hard time finding it. But let's just as an exercise, give me a x1 to x5, and I'll tell you what the output is.
Okay, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, or actually, you know what? All zeros.
Okay, all zeros. The output is 0.
Well, that's what I should. That's not what I should have done. I should have. No.
That's okay. I won't count that one.
Can I just give you like maybe 3 to the k of them, and you not count any of them until I get it right?
Well, that's the problem, right? Well, not 3 to the k, but if you make 2 to the k guesses, you'll be okay, but you'll also have looked at all possible inputs, so that's not really that interesting. But in particular, the example that I'm thinking of, you're going to have to guess almost this many just to get a positive example. So almost everything that you throw in is giving almost no information, because saying no doesn't really tell you very much.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. What I was thinking is I need to find one where the answer is yes.
Exactly. And I made it so that it's going to take you exponential time just to find one. Once you've found that one, then you're home free. But it's going to take you, you essentially have to enumerate all possibilities before you find one.
Okay, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. And you're going to tell me that 0, 0, 0.
There's only one pattern that gives a 1.
Right, exactly. And you're going to, because every single one of them is relevant, and I'm going to have to look.
2 of them are negated. This is the only pattern that gives you a 1. Now, once you found that and you know that that's the only one, now it's easy. You can just read off the equation. So what's the equation?
Xn not 2 and x3 and not and x4 and not x5.
And that's the equation. And as a learner, you're not going to be able to find that, right? Because it's just needle in a haystack until you hit it.
Yeah, so it's going to take me exponential time, but remember, we're not worried about time. We're worried about sample complexity. So remember the cheat that we have here. The cheat that we have here is that I know all the hypotheses and what they say.
It doesn't help you.
Yeah, it does, because the hypothesis, because every hypothesis, well, no, that's not true. I'm thinking the wrong thing. I'm sorry. I'm cheating. You're right. I'm cheating. I'm acting as if we had the example you had before.
So this constrainedness is really, it's very frustrating, right? Because the question that you really want to be able to ask, you can't really ask, right? You want to be able to ask a question that takes the hypothesis class and split it in half. And, well, maybe you can. I mean, maybe you can nearly do that, but it's still going to be, oh, no, sorry, that would make it linear. Let me say that again. You'd like to be able to ask a question that splits this hypothesis class in half, but unfortunately, almost all of your questions give very little information. It just knocks out a couple of the possible hypotheses. And so it ends up being 2 to the k kind of time, or not time, but samples, before you can get a handle on what the hypothesis is. So it's harder for the learner, too.
Right. So when the learner does it, you have no reason to believe one hypothesis over the other. You've got all of them. And so in order to figure it out, no, and it kind of has to be that way, because otherwise it's still linear. So this is bothering me. Because if what you said is true, then why does 20 questions work? Why do I ever get log 2?
Right. So we'd like to be able to ask questions. So here, let's play this game now. You think of a formula, And I'm a.
Wait. I know what the answer. The answer is that the 20 questions is still the optimal thing to do, given that you know nothing. So that log base two is kind of an expected answer. But sometimes you will do much worse, and sometimes you'll do better.
No, in this particular case, if I could ask you more general questions, I can do this in with the linear in K. So the questions that I'd like to ask you are things like: Is X1 in the formula? Yes or no? Is X1 positive in the formula? Is X1 negative in the formula? I can just fill in these boxes by asking the right questions. But
right.
But those questions are not in our constrained set. And it's the constrained set that matters here. And our constrained set is, in this particular example, just really harsh.
So, and there's no way to approximate that, right? So I can't say, okay, so the first question you want to ask is X1 positive, negative, or absent? So if I looked at all the hypotheses, I could do that by asking. Now, it's very hard to do because there's no direct way to ask that question. The only way to ask that question is I have to try all possible exponential cases to know.
Yeah, because we're constrained to only ask queries that are data points, right? So give me the label for this data point. And that's not really the same as, is the hypothesis you're thinking of having this particular property?
But as soon as I get a 1, I know something.
As soon as you get a 1, you're in a much happier place. So in fact, if we had conjunctions of literals without negations,
mm-hmm.
we'd be in a much better situation, because then your first question can be, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. You know the answer has to be 1, or the formula is empty. And so then you're basically off and running. But the fact that there can be negation in there means that most queries give you really useless information.
So Michael, okay, so you've depressed me. You basically said this is really hard to do, to learn, because I think we've convinced ourselves, at least you've convinced me, that until I get a 1, until I get a positive result, I can't really know anything. And eventually I will get 1 if I can just do an exponential number of samples, but then my sample complexity is exponential and I'm sad. So what you're basically saying is I'm sad. Sample complexity makes me a bad person, and there's really nothing I can do to learn anything or get anything good out of my learning process.
That seems like a very sad way of saying it.
Yes. Is there a happy way of saying it?
There isn't a happy way of saying that, but there are other questions that have happier answers.
Okay, like what?